Good evening. I'm Edwin Price, and you're watching the first instalment for the new season of the Barbican Young Reviewers. Now, the format is simple. We get given tickets to see a Barbican show. We take incredibly well-crafted and in-focus shots from around the centre, and then we find a stimulating intellectual backdrop from which to deliver a critical snippet or review on the content we've seen. So in my case, that's a garden shed. At least it's got a poster. Now I must admit, when I was told I would be reviewing The Vulgar Fashion Redefined, I was a little bit apprehensive. Fashion shows of this nature aren't usually my cup of tea. And I was concerned that, given the show's title, the audience would be required to have a certain understanding of Vulgar's opposite. That would be good taste. Now, I'm pleased to say the exhibition was accessible and required no prior understanding or grasp of what good taste is. The creative team combined effectively. Judith Clark, the curator, aptly selected 120 plus costumes and ready-to-wear looks from the Renaissance right through into the present day. And Adam Phillips, the psychoanalyst and writer, successfully maps definitions of vulgarity onto the works to expose their motivation and societal impact. Initially, I was struck by how Phillips supplied us with Samuel Johnson's definition of vulgar, given in the first dictionary, as the common people. Before the show, I would have defined vulgar as something coarse and simplistic, like someone telling a smutty joke or sticking their finger up their nose in plain sight. However, by mapping the word onto its historical and societal implications, the exhibition helpfully informs us as to what the roots of fashion are. It is presented as being a fight against being seen as common. In the late 18th century, for example, increased access to materials and the increasing wealth gap provided fresh space for fashion to celebrate difference. The exhibition presents the result of this development, gem-encrusted, billowing white dresses that appear, if not in good taste, then at least unique. However, as the exhibition goes on to show, the line between fashion and commonness can be broken down by mass production. In fact, vulgarity is presented as the process of making good art into bad art, i.e. of making fashion widely available. I think the show was fantastic in setting out and defining that process, and then going on to show how designers have played with it to strong effect. For example, in his 2014-2015 autumn-winter Chanel collection, Karl Lagerfeld had his models wearing the season's threads in a shopping mall somewhere in Paris. Big pictures of this stunt are presented at the gallery, with the clash of fashionable clothes and a common backdrop working against the elitist bias prevalent in the industry. Alongside these photographs are a selection of mundane items like paint pots and cans of soup that are also branded and heralded as works of art. Not only is this humorous, but it works against the continuum established earlier, that which is common is necessarily vulgar and always must be held at an arm's length from the world of fashion. Another effective instance of playing with form is with Andy Warhol's soup cans. Although the dress might not be to our taste, shot effectively highlights how fashion and commonness can be effectively meshed together to make us reassess what the limits of vulgarity are. Of course, though the design is popular as we understand it in an artistic sense, the dress is now held aloft in a glass cabinet at a gallery. Perhaps this is an instance of fashion winning out and closing the door on genuine commonness, as it embeds works or criticisms such as these within its framework. Though enlightened about vulgarity's long-standing role in defining fashion, I do have a few issues with this show. Though the layout is easy to follow, it lacks any real cohesion other than each section clinging to the word vulgar in a different way. For a summary of some 500 years of tradition, a bit of chronological signposting would have helped to embed the designers and the word vulgar into its social context. I also feel like the meta discussion that was happening around the exhibition was not helpful. Whilst it is interesting to think that this is the first exhibition that explores how fashion overturns and exploits the limits of taste, It was just perhaps a bit too much to keep forcing on how vulgar it was to show fashion in a museum in the first place. I think the stress slightly muddied the waters and drew what should have been a critical exhibition into the wider industry's worry with public display. My last point, though not positive or negative, it's just a point of confusion. Once I had navigated through the exhibition, I reached the shop and saw the normal books and bits, but also replica dresses of those being exhibited within the exhibition being sold at eye-watering prices. In a sense, by selling these items, the exhibition exposed itself as a kind of exponent of the industry and lost some of the critical distance it had earned from its material throughout the exhibition journey. In another reading of events, the temptation to buy at the end of the exhibition might have been a final test of the audience's taste. So the final verdict, go and see the show. If not necessarily for the aesthetic pleasure of the works on show, then for the interesting questions it raises about fashion and how it exacerbates and maintains social difference, and how Phillips compellingly dissects the word vulgar that defines us more than we might think. Until the next time a young reviewer examines something at the Barbican from a similarly stimulating backdrop, I've been Edwin Price, and thank you very much for listening.